Hi and welcome to a new video. In the last video, the C370 Battle of the Cheap, we did a comparison of the cheapest C370 motherboards. And the question is it even necessary to invest like double or triple the amount of money into a high-end overclocking or gaming motherboard? In the C370 Battle of the Cheap, I found out that the ASRock C370 Pro 4 can clock up to 4200 MHz on the memory and also 5 to 5.1 GHz on the 8700K was not really an issue. So today we will take the results from the C370 Battle of the Cheap and compare those results with the ASUS Maximus 10 Hero. Just by looking at it, you can already see that this is a motherboard out of the higher price category. So you can straight see the I/O shield, the cover here, that's looking quite nice. It's still plastic, but it looks good. There's also a lot of RGB stuff going on the motherboard, which looks quite nice if you set it to the correct color. And also you have those brushed aluminium look heatsinks everywhere, like the heatsink for the M.2 SSD in the middle. And I think it gives it a very high quality look. Also the PCB looks very nice. Personally, one of the most important features for me is the VRM, and the VRM on this board is really solid. It's an 8-phase VRM, and compared to the cheaper boards in the C370 Battle of the Cheap, those boards usually have like 4-phase VRM designs, and they don't always use power stages like in fully integrated power stage. They sometimes use like high side and low side MOSFETs split up into two packages and quite cheap components, cheap inductors. So that's probably the biggest difference from this board to the cheapest boards, and also obviously the BIOS. One feature I really like about those boards is this small installation frame. It's for the CPU. You can basically clip in your CPU from the back and then install your CPU using this installation frame. And well, you might laugh about it, but really it also happens to me once in a while that if you want to mount your CPU, you just accidentally drop it into the socket, you bend some pins. It's not the end of the world if you bend some pins. You can always bend them back if they're not breaking, but yeah, using this installation tool, usually your CPU doesn't drop into the socket, and it's very safe to install the CPU this way. So let's go over to the result data of this test. In the first test we have is the DRAM testing. So you can see the table comparing to the 4 cheapest motherboard, and you can see the ASUS Maximus 10 Hero did the whole test successfully. So even up to 4200 MHz with 2x8 GB was not a problem. Unfortunately, I didn't have 4266 memory sticks available because ASUS is advertising this as memory speed that should work on the board, but I don't really have doubts that it's working, because all of this was working quite nicely. If you experience any kind of memory issues with the board, there is in the DRAM timing control, there's an option, it's called Maximus Tweak, and there is mode 1 and mode 2. And sometimes it helps to just set this to mode 2 to allow your memory speed to run higher. So let's go over to the maximum power draw. In this chart, you can see that the cheaper boards, they could run from 115 to 131 watts under load. More load would cause the VRM to throttle, so this was the maximum power I could pull from the cheapest boards. And the ASUS Maximus 10 Hero was able to draw 210 watts, which is quite a lot more. It's almost double the power consumption. So that shows how much stronger the VRM on this board is compared to the cheap boards. So let's translate the power draw into real world data. So you can see the cheaper boards could run like 5 GHz, and the MSI C370A Pro could even run 5.1 GHz. And this is on an open test bench without any airflow, so that's like the worst case scenario running Prime 95. Obviously, if you're running this into a case that's very well ventilated, you can even hit higher numbers. And here you can see that the ASUS Maximus 10 Hero was able to run even 5.3 GHz at 1.424 volt, and that's actually more than enough. Keep in mind that the CPU I was using is an extremely binned CPU, so this is far above average. Usually you will be able to run 5 to 5.2 GHz on your CPU, depending on how good your sample is. Obviously, you have to delete your CPU to hit those numbers, like 5.1, 5.2, you have to delete your chip to hit those numbers stable for Prime 95. Running 5.3 GHz and 1.44 volt, it would eventually throttle down to 5 GHz, but well, 5.3 at 1.42 volt is still quite a lot and should be fine for 99% of the daily overclocks. Talking about overclocking, let's go over to a 5 GHz overclocking tutorial. You can use this as baseline if you want to overclock with the Maximus 10 Hero. So let's start with the overclocking. This guide will work for the i7-8700K and also for the i5-8600K. There is no difference between those CPUs when it comes to the overclock. So if you just received your mainboard, you should first check for newer BIOS versions on the ASUS website and update your BIOS first. After doing that, we go back to the BIOS and we set the AI overclock tuner to XMP and select no here. You can see that I'm using an XMP profile of 3600 and I'm using 4 memory sticks with 8 GB each, and you can see on the right side currently the memory is running only at 2133 MHz. So we have to configure the memory first, and that's also what I recommend. So first apply this and then we will go back to the BIOS. Now you can see on the right side that the memory is running at 3600 MHz, which is the correct clock, and the voltage is also correct at 1.35 V. Next thing we do is disable the ASUS multicore enhancement and set the AVX instruction core ratio negative offset to 3. This way the CPU will clock down by a ratio of 3 under AVX load. AVX is an instruction of your CPU and it basically puts a much higher workload on your CPU, resulting in a higher power consumption, and it's also much more stressing for the CPU. So using a negative offset of 3 means that your CPU will clock down by 300 MHz under load. So CPU core ratio you set to sync all cores and set this one to 50. This means that we will overclock the CPU to 5 GHz. Obviously you can always clock higher afterwards, but you should start with a stable base. Disable CPU SVID support, then go to external DigiPlus power control and set CPU load line calibration to level 6. This way the voltage will stay stable under load and it will stay at around the same level. If you use level 7, you will have quite a big overshoot over the idle voltage. That's not what we want, so I would recommend using level 5 or level 6. In internal CPU power management, you set the long duration power limit and short duration power limit to the maximum. Go back out and go to the CPU core cache current limit max. Also set this one to the maximum. Basically, we are disabling all the power limits, so the CPU will always stay stable at the highest clock and it will not throttle down. Minimum and maximum cache, we should start at 42. You can always increase it afterwards once you're done with the whole overclocking thing. You can adjust the CPU cache to a higher level. In certain applications, when they're really memory heavy, it can help you to increase the cache clock. BCLK aware adaptive voltage is a feature that can basically increase your CPU voltage while you're also increasing the BCLK, but I personally would never use this feature. I would always set both manually. So CPU core cache voltage we set to manual and set it to 1.35 V, which should be a safe base. You can use up to 1.4, 1.42, that should be no problem. Especially when your CPU is deleted, I don't think there's an issue using such voltages, because I've seen several CPUs that have this level, like 1.35 in stock voltage already, so shouldn't be an issue. You see that CPU VCC IO and CPU system agent voltage, they are already affected by the XMP. Usually they are much lower, like 1.1 V roughly, maybe even lower. You can see it's 1.23, 1.28 on auto now, which is still fine. You can use up to like 1.35 V without any issues, but probably it doesn't help too much if you increase it that high. So that's it already for 5 GHz. So we go to ASUS overclocking profile and just save our settings. Typing anything here, save it to profile 1. Then we will apply this setting and go to Windows. So we are back in Windows 10. So what we have to do now is obviously test the CPU for stability. So you have to check everything in CPU Z first. You can see that my CPU is clocking down in idle, which is absolutely fine. There is no effect on stability. If you don't want that, you go to your power saving options and you set, well, it's a German OS, but you set your power saving plan to high performance. And then you can see the CPU is clocking up to 5 GHz and it will stay always at 5 GHz. Under mainboard, you can see that I'm running the BIOS version 0505, which was the most recent version available at this point. On memory, you can see I'm running the 32 GB G-Skill Triton Z RGB memory with a cache of 4200 MHz. And here you can see the memory speed is correctly applied with 1800 MHz, aka 3600 MHz, because it's DDR for double data rate. You can also see it here in the SPD what kinds of modules I'm using. So after applying settings like this, it's very helpful to just do a Cinebench run, because this way you can check if there is a quick issue in temperatures. You can see I'm hitting like 70 degrees Celsius, which is absolutely fine because obviously my CPU is deleted. You can also see the CPU is staying stable here. You can always right click into CPU C to see the core clock of all cores. You can also see the CPU voltage under load is 1.36 volt, which is due to the load line calibration, so that's also correct. Now we can see the performance was 1650 points, which is absolutely where we should be at 5 GHz. Well, plus minus 20, 30 points, depending where your cache frequency is at and also what kind of memory modules and memory speed you're using. For the real stability testing, we will use Prime95 in the version 26.6, which is without AVX, and the load of this is roughly the same as running Cinebench R15, so it's a very good and also a real world performance testing and stability testing. So set minimum FFT and maximum FFT to 1344. Check run FFTs in place and just simply hit OK. Now you should leave this running for around 1 hour. Keep checking the temperature in core temp. You can see I'm now hitting like 75 degrees Celsius, which is still absolutely fine. You can go up to like 95 degrees Celsius, but I noticed on those CPUs that the higher you go in temperature, it definitely affects stability of your CPU. So if you have a better water cooling loop and you hit like maybe only 50 degrees Celsius under load, you might be able to clock higher than me here. If you have stability issues at this point, you still have headroom in the voltage, so you can go up to like 1.4, 1.42 volt and check if this helps you. Also, still keep in mind that you have to stay away from like higher than 95 degrees Celsius, so always keep the temperature in mind. If this is running stable, you can also go back to the BIOS and increase the CPU multiplier to like 51 or 52, which equals 5.1 GHz or 5.2 GHz, and simply test how high you can push your CPU. I hope this small tutorial helped you. If you have any kind of questions, problems with a tutorial, just simply put it in the comments. Otherwise, enjoy the rest of your day and see you soon.